Yes, do we have sound? We have sound. Good morning, everybody. There are more chairs here, so please fill them up. Five more, six, seven. There's sound and video screen upstairs, so if you see too many people move in at the back, please inform them that they can also watch and listen upstairs. Welcome at the start of the IETM, and I think it's the second day of the Trans-Europe Hall meeting, isn't it? I would love to introduce you to my colleague, Birgitta Persson, Secretary General of Trans-Europe Hall.
And this is my dear colleague, Nan van Houten, Secretary General of IETM.
And we are very good colleagues and very happy that we could organize this one event in collaboration.
And we do several collaborations together now. We started a big EU project together, Creative Lenses. And now, for the first time, we actually come together with our meetings in the same place. And it's very timely that we come together to Hungary, to Budapest today. And we wanted to... It's important for us that we organize this event in solidarity with the independent cultural actors here in Hungary who are fighting for an open and inclusive Hungary.
And we are very happy that today we get an opportunity to hear some stories behind the pictures and the short messages that we get through the media. So I'm happy to hand over the mic to Nick Thorpe, BBC journalist living in this country for over 29 years now. So he is an insider from the outside. And we have two insiders from the inside sitting next to him. Give a hand to Nick Thorpe, please.
Thank you very much. And welcome to Budapest on this beautiful sunny morning, on this beautiful river, on this beautiful white room. I'm very pleased to be joined in the panel, in our discussion this morning, by Ildikó Tokács. Ildikó is a freelance consultant on cultural projects. She's the former head of the Hungarian Cultural Centre in London, and is also working very closely today in the Hungarian Film Foundation training program. Also on the panel is Máté Gáspár, formerly of the Krétakör, of the Chalk Circle Theatre Company project, and nowadays development director of the Budapest Festival Orchestra, and he also teaches at the University of Film and Drama. A very well-known figure in Hungarian cultural life, like as Ildikó. Is Hans van Vliet in the room anywhere? There was a gentleman called Hans van Vliet, who, if he arrives, please join us on the panel. We were also meant to be joined by András Doncev of the Hungarian government. I know many of us here on the panel and in the audience, no doubt, would have had questions. It would have been very nice to welcome him today. Unfortunately, he did drop out yesterday at the last minute. He has other very important commitments. There are a lot of changes, as ever, in Hungarian cultural life. But if anybody in his place from the audience would like to represent Hungarian government cultural policy, we would very much welcome your views, and we'll do our best also to try, and I as moderator will do my best to try and weave in what András might have said were he here. I think we should sit down. And Judy, are you going to take part with us? Yes, very good. Thank you for a bit. We're all very pleased that Judy Szabó is stepping in at the last minute as founder and managing director of TRAFO, the House of Contemporary Arts here in Budapest. And again, another iconic figure of Hungarian artistic and cultural life. Please join us on the panel. So I think we'll sit down and start. I thought to get the discussion going this morning, and I'd also like to impress on you, we're very keen to hear your views, have your contribution in the next hour and a quarter or so of this discussion, the main theme of which is to introduce to you Hungarian culture, Hungarian artistic life today, what's going on, what's at stake today in Hungary. And so we're very keen to hear your own views, your own comparisons with what's happening in this relatively short time that we've got in your own countries, but also from the Hungarians in the audience as well, very much like your participation. And I thought, as a sort of to get the discussion going, I, as a journalist covering Eastern Europe, have spent most of the last 3 months at one or other of Hungary's borders covering the refugee crisis. I also noticed that on the opening page of the IETM website, there is a call for artistic projects dealing with and artistic responses across Europe to the refugee crisis. The deadline for that, as you may have noticed, is November the 16th, so you still have 11 days to apply. But I thought I'd start by asking Ildikó, Gyuri, and Máté what they know of, what they know of the artistic responses so far, what they're aware of at this moment going on in Hungary in response to this great Greek drama.
Okay.
Máté.
I start. Good morning, everybody. well, oops. Sorry. Okay, I turn my back to you next. Please don't feel offended. Okay, like it will be better. So you're absolutely right to start by this question, because it has really been the most important topic, and it has really been a dramatic situation in Hungary the last 3 or 4 months. First, as I'm sure that most of you have followed closely, first there was a real invasion of all kind of migrants coming from different areas, and it was something absolutely unattended, both for the officials but also for the general public, the Hungarian civil society, and we had very moving times to find the good reactions, because the official reactions, of course, were rather hostile and also quite impotent, actually at the very beginning. But the civil society has mobilized itself in an amazing way. So we witnessed to a wave of solidarity which was absolutely unknown, and absolutely not as spectacular as it became during these few very hot summer weeks. And I think that with this help and with this really very, very touching and also very efficient help, which was basically a humanitarian aid from inhabitants of Budapest and also inhabitants of those cities living at the south of the country where the migrants massively entered, helped those people to survive their few days or weeks in that they passed in Hungary, because obviously no one really wanted to stay in Hungary, and this is still the case, and it has been the case the few past years as well. So Hungary is not a destination country for people coming to Europe in search of a better life. So that's why it was particularly alarming to hear the official propaganda saying that we as Hungarians and we as Hungarian state have to defend ourselves and have to defend our way of living and our culture. And that's why I think it's a it's a pertinent question, because culture has not been mentioned as often as it is now. It became again a main topic. What is our culture, what is Hungarian culture, and what is European culture in large. Let me quote our Prime Minister, who just yesterday delivered a speech at the Hungarian Academy of Science, which hosts an event similar to ours, or even a bit bigger. It's the World Science Forum taking place in Budapest with some 4,000 delegates from all over the world. And Mr. Orbán gave the opening speech. And he told that we as Europeans have to be very aware of what's going on, because he feels that the real stake is not considered by the European societies, and if we don't watch out, our culture, our way of living, and our former life will be challenged and can collapse. So this is the official opinion. And what kind of responses can be done? What kind of, what's the room for alternative voices? Very little. Partially because of, I think, by fear of interfering with the official propaganda, which has been very massively spread in all kind of public media surfaces, but also because, according to a recent survey, more than 75% of Hungarians are happy, for instance, with the fence, and endorse the government's policy to close the country with physical barriers from people who are trying to pass through the country. So it's that there is a sort of mutual consensus between the majority of the population and the official opinion. So we have relatively few, so the smallest part of the society who thinks differently and who dares to speak out along those venues. So just let me quote two examples that I'm aware of. A well-known filmmaker and theater director, Kornél Mundruczó, he's just opened at the autumn festival, which is called the Budapest Café Festival. A play that he had presented before in the Netherlands, and I think it was in the Rotterdam Opera, which is an adaptation of the Winterreise of Schubert, where the video installation part showed pictures of refugees, and this whole wandering story was somehow matched with the current lives of a refugee coming to Europe. So this was one of the examples that I saw recently. And the other one is a new production in a small alternative theater called the Studio Cat that I hope that you will have the chance to meet. And it's a documentary play opened 2 weeks ago called Határaink, Our Borders, which explores the opinion and reaction of Hungarian citizens towards this new phenomena, having people looking differently than we coming to our home. So it's also quite an important work, but one of the very rare ones.
Thanks very much. Ildikó. Okay.
Then I quickly, because I just don't, I want Judy to stay with us as long as he can, and he has to leave earlier. So actually, to being in culturally sensitive, it's very hard to live through what's happening here, because culture now appears in a completely different context as before, and in a way that that's the only way that I think we can somehow bridge this situation, what's happening here right now in Hungary. So just joining actually the project that we were discussing, that Verzió Film Festival, the press conference is right now, it's a documentary film festival. They have a section for refugee-themed films and also a workshop about this. But actually when we were discussing a little bit before we met, we realized that it's not so many projects. And it's interesting why art and why cultural sector is not reacting stronger. However, as I mentioned, culture is appeared in a completely different role than before, because as Mate was reading loud, that actually the mainstream saying about why we have to fear and why we have to be threatened about this refugee crisis, because a different culture is going to destroy ours. And this is the main issue that all the politician is constantly repeating, and making Hungarians, and I think not only Hungarians, but in Hungary is quite strongly seen as frightened. And I have to say that this is a great brainwash, because people, even if they're not practicing culture every day, this is something that they say, okay, Islam is going to destroy the Christian culture in Europe. So this is easy, easy to understand, easy to communicate. So for, I think, culturally sensitive person, it's even more sadder, or really makes us feel bad that they use culture in a very wrong way. So I do hope that somehow the reaction for the cultural sector and the culture makers become a bit stronger. But there's another example. I think a lot of photographers were there. So I was recently at a book launch at Open Society Archive, and there was a Hungarian photographer showing very strong pictures. So lots of photographers and filmmakers, primary, who reacted first, I think, in an artistic way to this Greek drama, as you mentioned. Sorry.
So on my territory, let's say performing art, I would like to summarize what is the main change, is that there's lots of money, bunch of money in the institutions, at the institutions, and no money on civil society level. So it means the on project level. On the top of the institutions, there are, let's say, appointed directors, and so they have they don't have a strong link to the political era, but anyway, there is a kind of self-censorship. It's very, very, very strong. It's built in, and somehow the system reminds me, because I'm old so much, to the one-party system. And which is new for me is, one is in, for example, József Katona Theater, which is, let's say, the traditional big theater. They took over the language of independent theater, which is much more straightforward. Because before, in the 90s, 80s, 70s, 60, no, 60s, no. So there, each play had a double bottom, you know, a double meaning. You have to read the lines or to hear out what is their sense. But it's much more straightforward. So I'm very happy for that. But at the same time, it's a big question what the independent scene will do in theater, because this kind of aesthetic value has been taken away. It became part of the market. It's very strange to say that. And what's new? The independent scene is the first scene which is international, and very international, like Cornel Mudruzzo, Árpád Csilling, Victor Bodo, and Béla Pintér. So they are internationally recognized. And in dance, it was not typical at all. But now there's a young generation, because they were grown up in an international context, and now they are on the international scene. And so it means the theater made it maybe around the beginning of the 2000, and now we can see in dance the same things. Okay. And what else, what I can see, because there's less money, much more smaller projects, bigger project can come into life, existence, if there's an international network. So that's why in Central Europe, I guess everybody looks for international collaboration, because that's the only way to make bigger pieces. And I think this is the key to the freedom of self-expression. That's very important. So, for example, Truffaut as the major venue for this performing art. So our policy is to provide as much freedom for the artists as is possible. So we increased our performance number from 150 up to 220 with the same stuff. So we became a very strong machine. Bad side of it, we don't have relationships so much with the artists, because we don't have time to speak. Because we have to generate. Yeah, this is very, very sorrowful for me. But, you know, this is the way how to serve somehow the community, because if they don't have subsidy, if they do good pieces, we have to good, very good marketing, seven persons work on it. Sometimes it works, sometimes it's not. But anyway, at least the ticket income, the most of the companies, they get the ticket income. So this is the big transition for me. The other problem is for the independent scene, there's no real advocate of the independent scene because in the former time, as a Truffaut director, I really went to the, let's say, the professionals, and I could really protect the independent scene's interest. But now, at the moment, this kind of relationship has melted down, so you can see nobody came here. So that's a very important sign. What is the dialogue? There is no discourse at all. But I guess in the near future, because the situation is getting so bad, so missing really a vision of the future, and I guess now the government, maybe I'm too optimistic, they feel that something is wrong because so many young artists want to leave Hungary. So that's a key, probably a possible keyword for them, the future generation. Because politically, they're really motivated to stop the older independent generation, let's say the big generation, because they are very outspoken, so they are straightforward. And they would like to change it. You know, it's very strange how they think. And for example, these theater makers, they would like to see in the, let's say, the state theaters, which is very very strange argument for me. I don't know what is in their mind, because it's so much different aesthetic. So if somebody would take over a theater, then they should fire the most of the actors and actresses because they have to use these special actors and actresses for their own quality. So there are so many controversial. So very briefly, what I feel that there are many, many sentences, strange visions from the government, but it's not coherent at all. It's much more scattered. And there are some certain personalities, they have a certain very, very strange vision. And they try to impose it to the field, but if that person would fall out, let's say from the governmental elite, then the person will disappear immediately. So it's very hard to say what is this, but that's important. That's very clear for us. This hybrid culture, what we represent. It's for them, it's absolutely not necessary. They would like a much more popular culture. So they want support music, including classical music, new circus, creative industry, but not so much documentary film, for example. You know, so these are the all elements what I can see, and very hard to get in the position to speak to them at the table on equal level, yeah, in a partnership. So that's a question, to resist all the time, or resist and talk with them, you know, to negotiate with them, you know. So that's I guess that's the next step, because this way what we are trying to protect ourselves, it's okay, but we cannot find all the time solutions internationally. We have to make our battles at the round tables ourselves. That's my opinion. Maybe I have to go very soon. So that's why I would like to summarize my perspective.
Thank you very much. At this point, any contributions from the floor? Any questions or comments?
Immediately, before you leave, Turi, maybe it's, can you explain, because you told us that when you were a director, you could defend the independent scene, and now you can't anymore. Can you explain why?
Matt is the same situation, you know, so it's a very strange, so we are, let's say, professionally respected, but I have to tell you, many, many very, very professional people without job, or they are put aside totally. So so what's going here, it's an intellectual tragedy. It's an exile. And it's really very hard. I have three children, so you know, so I'm I'm the person who have all the time vision, and it's really difficult to tell them what to do.
So you have lost your job?
But after 3 months, Joseph Nagy asked me to come back. And so he is the director, and I'm the managing director. So we can do whatever we want anyway. We, as I said to you, we have more money. But our partners, the artists, they don't have money. You know, so it's very inconvenient situation. You know, so you want to spend it. You know this somehow, but it's how, because for example, for us, which is an essential problem, if I want to work with the artist, there should be a structure, but no structure. You know, so how can I communicate with them? How can the project be pulled up to a certain measure? And how can we raise the public?
Ildikó, is there freedom of expression in Hungary today?
Just a quick reflection, because there's some kind of completely joining to what Yuri said, that for you to understand. So it's now it's a huge question. Either you leave Hungary and you do your profession somewhere else and leading festivals, and I have lots of friends who left Hungary and were working in Germany, in the UK, doing festivals, cultural programming, great things. Or that other half of my friend decided, yes, this I am professional, so I try to stay in my profession, but then your dreams and your evenings are not easy. Because you have to balance between doing something right and how what is my border? So what is my border to do things and to negotiate things and talk to everyone? Or when do I say, oh, that's my stomach is not bearing anymore? So it's those questions which honestly I've never thought that I would meet. I have heard from our parents that it can happen. So it's very, very hard to create value either here or somewhere else. But if you leave, then of course, then your responsibility, your Hungarianness, all your knowledge and all your roots and everything, then you can use it, fine. But then it's not the same. So it's not a black and white question. So I cannot say anyone else that for example, like working for the National Film Fund, there's a lots of things that I love what they are doing, but obviously there's a lots of things that I'm not very happy with doing. So should I work for them or should I not work for them? I can add something to this era, or so it's very, very hard to decide that if you would like to create a value, whether you are joining and it's not a good word, fighting, but trying to represent your values. It's possible, but it has a brilliant many of questions.
Marty, would you like to comment on that?
Just a last thought about this refugee question. I think that the official Hungarian opinion about this whole issue is really hypocritic, because, as you probably know, some 400,000 Hungarians left the country and migrated to the western part of Europe during the last 5 years. So Hungarians are migrants themselves as well, and partially those who lost their possibilities or their perspectives in the cultural life as well, but many others, of course, who are active in different parts of the market. So I think that we are also part of this movement, as you said. Also many. We are also constantly thinking about whether we should stay or whether we should rather leave and try something else somewhere else. And this is not because we would not love our country, or we would not love our culture, or we would not be very motivated to make things better here, but because of sheer lack of possibilities or the restrictive environment. Mm. So I think that this migration issue will remain on the agenda and in a much larger sense than it's treated now with people coming from Syria and Afghanistan. just yesterday I've received an online survey from an outstanding organization based here in Budapest, which is called Budapest Observatory, led by Peter Inkei. I'm sure that many of you know him very well, because he's also an emblematic figure of the cultural life, not only in Hungary, but in Central Europe and beyond. And they are doing regularly a cultural climate barometer. And so they just launched this online survey yesterday, where they ask questions about what are the climatic conditions for culture in your country. So it's not only for Hungary, but for all over Europe. So I strongly recommend you to have a look on that survey and give your opinion. And when I was opening this survey, and the first question was, what are the most problematic factors for culture in your country today? And there I'm offered 25 different statements that I should choose five from. Actually, I started to click on them, and when I could not go after five, out of the first five, or first six, I checked back the rule of the game, and there I discovered that actually I can only check five. So I had a hard evening and a hard night, as you thought yesterday, because I was looking at it and I thought, no, come on, it cannot be possible that 25 out of the 25 would be an equal match, and I could argue for all of them why it's problematic. So I thought, okay, let's move on and let's see the rest. And then a few pages later, you have the opposite. What are the five most promising or most positive aspects influencing the cultural climate in your country? Where very wisely the same statements are turned into positive. So I thought, okay, let's see. And with all my good intentions and optimism towards the future, I could not choose one. Because then on the last page there was an open place that please put your comment or advice how to improve this survey. And what I had to put there, that I'm sorry, Peter, but here and now it's impossible to make statement in this white or black manner. So I cannot choose the five most burning problems, but I cannot either put five positive aspects if they are put at the extreme poles of the same phenomena. And I think this is the our reality, and that's why we are struggling, and we are staying, all those who don't want to leave, because you cannot, or I don't feel like saying that this is just bad or this is the just good, but the network of the problems is very complex and very very tough. So I would not even I suggest you go and check this place, this platform, and you will understand what I'm talking about. And I'm sure that many of these problems are very present in your countries as well. But for me, it was striking to see that there is really no difference between cultural policies lack relevance to fundamental issues of society, which is right, and exodus of cultural talent from the country. This is right as well, or low professional level of cultural managers, which is well as well. So one has the difficulty from which end to tackle this tough network of problems, and therefore the only possibility that we focus on our little territories, and maybe we will talk about it a bit later at the university, for instance, what can be done with small groups of young generation, future professionals, but on the policy level, it's very gloomy.
Jury, while you're still here, I wanted to ask. You know, I notice in the media, for example, looking at Hungary from outside, there's especially in the German press, there's a lot of views that somehow, or people assume that freedom of expression is dead in Hungary, that somehow everything is so state-controlled that people can't say their views, express them. But in my experience in the media, in fact, there is a plethora of opinions. It's actually a very exciting time in terms of what one can read, especially online, notwithstanding all the lack of advertising in anything other than pro-government media. But do you feel, at Trafo, any pressure at all on what you show, on the expressions of what's going on? Or is there still, because, you know, I'm, like you, was old enough to experience the 1980s here and the pressures which artists were under, the silencium, the silence imposed on a playwright like István Csurka, for example, who later went in other directions. But it's, how are you under pressure at Trafo? Are artists in Hungary, apart from all the issues of funding and so on, which I know are central, but are you under pressure to put on certain shows or not?
So it's absolutely, in a way, incomparable with the 80s, because if I did, very often I was called to meet with a representative of the secret police, you know, when I did at least 7 or 8 times, they did not punish at all, but they said, why? So we had a real strong quarrels. Nowadays, not at all. So there's no censorship. I can tell you this. If I can say that, there are two kind of censorship. It's self-censorship. It's very strong, and through the, which is much more delicate way, no money or less money, and less and less and less money. But the third thing, which is also very typical, but these are not special, not Hungarian, and they create such a situation when you can be easily corrupted. I guess the biggest issue for me, the corruption of the system. So how can you draw your borderline when you say yes or no? You know, so you have to be very strong in your values. And that's very important. I guess for me, the recent government in itself, it's not an issue. Because I guess the government comes, the government goes. There must more. I'm economist basically, so that's why I have a different mentality. Whatever. The problem is much more that many valuable artists, persons are pushed aside, and they have to go to the commercial side. And there are much more questions, and I'm very interested in. How can we protect the art? Because in a very strange way, the art is the cradle of commercialism, because the value is born in art, and the commercial mechanism take it over when it became very obvious there is a value, you know. So I would say that it's a question of input and output. What is culture policy? But personally, and with your institution or with your network, what you can do to protect art or feed the art, because that's for me, it's a big key question. I tell you one example. I don't want to say which institution, a very famous institution, not in Hungary. I went there and I saw there a performance, 1,000 seats, from maybe South Korea. And I was really surprised because it was very pompous, very colorful, not so much meaning, and so on. But the public adored it, really, which is a cult place. And then I spoke to people, the management. So I'm surprised seeing this one. Of course, the government was behind this event. And then I started to talk, why don't you invite Hungarians? And for example, I said to them, Kornél Mudrucó, they have a big set. And I guess quite welcomed. And I heard that it's not our aesthetics. And I said, then I had a question. So I saw this South Korean stuff. South Korean? Yeah, South Korean. It was not your aesthetics, but this is their life, you know. And I said, okay, so if you want to know, for example, what Gáspár was meant, so you should invite this kind of company. No, it's not your aesthetic. because anyway, they will just know what's going there in the East, or Central Europe, like Kusturica's film, you know, which is not true. It's a very, very well-done film. I like Kusturica.
Which of his films?
Other films. He's all films like that. Yeah, it's all about, you know, it's what makes stronger the cliches about our region. You know, but, for example, Cornel Mudruzzo or whatever, so they don't come over because we have a strategy and a connection with the public. So do we want to educate them? So do we feel responsibility when we say Europe and the diversity? You know, our partners, the Hungarian partners, they all struggle very often with the Western partners, but because they keep saying that, oh, this is not aesthetics, but we have to buy the Western, let's say, artworks, which is okay. But when Viktor Orban goes to abroad, he sees exactly the same thing, you know? And that's why he's very popular, because this kind of, value communication, value change, exchange, is there's a stuck there, and his answer, you know, I don't agree with that. Because I sit down again with the people, okay, let's talk with the professionals. I believe in small steps. But in Central Europe, where there's a different historical background, you can find much more people like Orban Viktor. They want big steps because they want to be heroes. So that's my response. So this would be interesting to talk about it, because this is what I can see, I have to tell you, on our professional level.
Is there someone else from the floor that would like to contribute or ask something at this point? Is anyone there who wants to come in? If there isn't, Ildikó.
Yes, I would have a comment on both. I might be a bit black and white in that, but what you were just reading out, I haven't read, is Observatory. I probably could quote a couple of problems which might change a little bit, but I don't know how it will happen. This is the cultural management and cultural leadership, which is missing in Hungary, and now we have actually jury. It's not very easy to quote five person in Hungary who understand business and culture, and I'm not saying that because you're economist, but I think for the future, I know it's a hard time for cultural institutions because of lack of government funding, but I think this is the key for the future, to learn how to be more independent from the government, because if the source of the funding we rely on, which happened in Hungary the last, I don't know how many years, so then the independence will not arrive. And no, I'm not saying because if somebody gives the money, they can dictate, because it would not be good. But for an institution, and this is a bit of my learning from the UK, where I spent 5 years trying to sell Hungarian culture, and I think it's possible. It was always possible, and I didn't want to sell it as Hungarian, but as the quality of the art. So that was the reason that we could organize the photography exhibition at the Royal Academy of Art and all the musical event, Budapest Festival Orchestra. So if the quality is there, I don't have to emphasize that it is Hungarian. But I agree with you, we have to learn how to get in touch those decision makers more in the mainstream culture and also in the alternative culture to participate more. But that's, again, something that beside cultural management and cultural leadership, I think we have to learn that numbers and economy is not our enemies being in a cultural world. But sometimes I'm really not very welcome saying this, although I'm not an economist, but still I somehow feel that there is a way that we can persuade our decision makers that culture is not just some fluffy, fluffy lilac, not money-making and not socially important things, because I'm sure that some of you read the first survey done by Ernst & Young about growth, which first time trying to also show numbers what cultural and creative industry makes in Europe, this 540 billion euros, 7 million jobs. So it's not only about money, but it's about people, and it's about creation, and it's about, as I said, bridging in the refugee crisis and Europe. So this culture is much more than just that we are thinking about it is in Hungary. So I think even if it's a bit change of the mindset would happen in this country, which now I don't really feel that's the room for this, then maybe there is a hope then decision makers would take culture in a bit upper level and realize that investing in money that's also not that makes money and makes jobs and makes a healthier society. And that's exactly, I have to say that, first of all, I was a bit like, a bit negative that culture is so capitalist in the UK. Because I said, why is everything is based on money? And living there and understand that it's not only negative. Because it's much freer, it's much more professional, and you can do really relevant thing if there is a kind of measurement behind, and it's not destroying the quality at all. So that was a big change in my mindset, because I had a bit of prejudice that how can these two things put together? But then I have to say that it changed, and now I'm a bit more critical for our cultural, sector.
Yeah, someone from the floor.
Thank you, Willie White from Ireland. Just to respond to Ildiko's remark there, I think we should not let go of the value that comes with public support of culture, because there are different values with private, whether it be private companies or private individuals. We can think of many controversies where art institutions running biennales were taking money from petroleum companies or whomever. So I think a responsibility then comes when artists make work with public money. And I don't think that necessarily the interests of private companies are the interests of the public all the time. So I think we should be very careful. We're lucky in the UK, or those in the UK are lucky, because there are lots of trusts and foundations. But the record of companies supporting culture is not always a good one. So I think we should hold on to. And then the question that we have to ask ourselves is why we do not have the trust of the public and of the politicians they elect when it comes to supporting culture. That, to me, is an important value that should not be relinquished.
Yes, I have just a quick reflection. It would be good if those public money would be as transparent as private money. So I would be very curious about the price of an opera ticket, for example, from our taxpayers' money, to see how much money invested, for example, in the Hungarian opera, how much visitors are there, and to very openly and transparently seeing which happened. Actually, in London, a Royal Opera House, we had a very open debate for the members who were supporting, and they were very open about the sources. The 90 million pounds over that time, 40 million public, 30 million private, 10 million supporters or sponsorship money. So I'm just saying that it would be nice to handle those public money so transparent as a private source, for example.
I think there was someone over there, but first I'd come back to you, perhaps on the music side, as development director of the Budapest Festival Orchestra.
Well, I just wanted also to give a quick reaction, because I fully agree with what you said about this. I think that we have to be very aware of what kind of values we are attaching to when we are establishing cooperation with private partners. But I think that Ildiko has right that when working or exploring the partnership with a private partner, you can be it's easy to read what this company stands for, and it's easier to decide whether you would like to cope with that or not. There has been cases, for instance, with the orchestra as well, when we thought that even a prestigious company would have loved to join and become a sort of sponsor for a particular event, but we have considered that what kind of products they are making, what kind of values they are working for, what do they mean by educating future audiences, and we decided not to get into corporations because we felt that, for instance, these were not healthy products, or these were not environmentally clean proposals. So we gently decided to pull out from these conversations. And I think it's feasible when you work with the privates, because they are transparent enough. The problem with the public funds, especially here in Hungary, and that's what Yuri referred to as well, that it's not transparent. And when you start having the feeling as a Hungarian citizen that you don't trust your own public subsidizers because they don't stand for the same values, or I could be more critical in my sentence, then it becomes problematic because this is how far you can go in negotiations with them, and how far you can align your intentions and values with the ones represented by public authorities, and I think that's why we feel so nervous here, because we are full of ideas and we are absolutely sure that those projects should be developed, but we are getting more and more reluctant to cope with the representatives of the public authorities, whether it's a grant scheme or it's a venue or just the people whom you should shake hands, and it's getting really more and more tough, especially, and I think this is the big news. Since you have, since IETM came here last time, the last 10 years, that this idea of the current regime about creating the, and we were just laughing about it when it was first announced, the system of national cooperation, it's called, and it's now a sort of reality. So it's such a centralized and hegemonical structure of the society that there is very little room left around it, whichever way you would like to be around. So it's a real question for everybody, whether you cope with this national collaboration system or not. And if you are not part of the game, and if you don't feel like joining, what's left?
Thanks. Someone at the back there. Yeah.
Hello, Anna Hopfer from France. I would like to ask you, in what way would you describe the relation to the public? If you said in the beginning that there were 75% okay with what happened with the stopping with the border, so how does this change? How do you define the work with the public?
This question?
Whoever would like to answer it. Yuri, for example.
It's a crucial question. which is interesting because you talked about the press, you talked about the media. So it's interesting because we don't work so much anymore with the with traditional, so with the offline, and even in the TVs and so on and so on. So we try to, we have a strong focus on online communication, though we see what is the limit of it, so we can do less and less. So it's a big question now, how to support the artworks now in the near future, because there's a constant change and very, very quick change. And now what I can see, for example, the government wants to enter into the online world. It's getting very clear. It's a recent new strategy for them. With the public, so the Hungarian public is quite poor. I'm used to say that. So, you know, mostly those are who are interested in new stuff, and more potential audience leave Hungary. So I met with somebody and he said, "Yuri, your public is beyond the border," and I said, "Yes, in a way, true." The other interesting issue for us...
But you can still read them. You can still reach them, I guess, thanks to the new media.
But anyway, which is also interesting, there's a new public flow in Budapest, because the majority of the university students coming from the countryside or from abroad. But it's two different cultures. And what we can experience who come from the countryside. So the main problem of Hungary, the urbanization level is very low. That's why there is no mobility, and that's why my answer, there is no management. Because the management needs mobility. It's very clear. If there is no market, no manager, because the artists can do themselves, the free phone calls, that's all, you know. So that's very simple. So the question for us, so a total ignorant public, potential public, flows into the Budapest market. How can we work with them? We have to find this new method, because it needs a slow integration process. The online is a very good chance to find out something, but it works, let's say, in the last 5 years, but I see a new tendency. I guess more and more people, I don't believe so much on online. I heard that in Germany, the youngers, they don't come on Facebook now. They look for something else much more. What I can see, you will come to Müsi, I guess one day. For example, which is a new thing, it's a very shocking, but very positive thing. In Müsi, every Monday, there are 400 kids playing games from 12 till 2 o'clock in the night. So it's unbelievable. You know, I took there some managers from our network, and they were shocked, I mean, positively, that they said, there's an iPhone. They don't use iPhones. You know, they just play different games. You know, so that's something positive. We have to see there's a transition in the society. We have to come closer to the smaller circles all the time. And you have to do a very direct communication. So that's what we can do. But that's a question. So how the society mentality will change in a larger scale? That's a question. And if you can see that, you can build a certain relationship to these changes. And that's, I'm trying to figure it out. What is this? So what we also learned that, for example, I'm a member of this research group, the locality is the new thing, and not the internationalism. There was a very nice TEDx presentation by a black woman from, no, not black, it's not PC. How is it, should I say it? Yeah, it's fine, okay. Speaking about America, her origin is something like African, different African. And it was very interesting to see that. And if I understand this new kind of thinking, we have to understand, let's say, the presenters and promoters, that we have to, so it works, our communication works if the references meet. But in that case, you have to know your target group, and you have to know the value of your, let's say, art piece. And so, and then how to mediate it. It's getting a profession. I talk too much.
Just one reaction, although I really, to your questions, I can't really answer, because now I'm not working, I'm not representing an institution, so I'm not really working with audiences or with public. But just some thought that I could say, that it's a good sign that it's not easy to get any theatre ticket. So I'm now an audience, and saying to you my experiences. So you have to be very quick to get a Katona Józsefszín has a theatre ticket, which I think it's not a bad sign. But on the other hand, it was very sad that, for example, the recent movie premiere, Veszettek, which was funded here heavily by the National Film Fund, and which has a very, very actual topic, was visited very few people. And obviously, there is a lots of reason for it. Why? You could blame the marketing, you could blame lots of things, why not? But my question is that whether Hungarian society now is ready for such a film. Are they interested in such a film? Because unfortunately, I have heard, and I'm not sure that it's true, that all these against refugee campaign, which was in Hungary in the summer, first I thought this is a brainwash, and then someone told me, no, no, it was a very careful market research when it came out, which actually Mate said that 75 or even more percent of Hungarian not really like foreigners. So let's use this and let's build on this feeling and so get more voters for my party to build on this. And if it's true, I'm saying I'm not sure that it, I don't know if it's true, it was just a gossip, but if it's true, that it's very frightening, because I think that's such a responsibility from a government to build on this kind of not very good kind of perception, this fear of foreigners, that would last longer than we were live, I think. So this is a kind of long-lasting responsibility which probably nobody thinks about. So, but back to the audiences, so that's all my experiences. I can say that actually, and also not easy to get ticket to Truffle, so which is a good sign. So there is a niche audience still interested in contemporary and alternative art. And then we were also discussing there's an interesting thing what's happening in Hungary, that there's a lot of hugely interesting things happening in the alternative art world, which is the mainstream culture has big questions what's happening there. But it's a funny thing how maybe we are used to this, that the mainstream culture is so prescient and so influenced by politics, and that's a good response that alternative culture can flourish. But I have to say that it's not my generation, but below one, two generations in the 20s, there's a lot of interesting things things happening. As low budget, even one of the film which was most visited in Hungary was a very low budget film. And a no-name filmmaker, Van Valami Érdekes, so €30,000 and almost 100,000 visitors, which is a very high number in Hungarian cinemas. So I'm just saying that it's an interesting phenomena which I encounter in Hungary today, that although the mainstream culture has questions, the alternative has very interesting answers.
And I'd like to react as well to a couple of things you've both said, or that have been said today. I never thought I'd find myself quoting the Pope, but the globalization of indifference. There's a very interesting conversation in a book published relatively recently by Karachan Gabor. Gabor Karachan, his work's not translated into English, though I think some that I know of. And he's a writer, a participant in the 1956 revolution, who died very sadly this summer, but very much someone culturally on the right-hand side, on the pro-Fidesz side of the cultural divide in Hungary today. He relates a conversation between himself, and his novels are very interesting, that they weave in real characters and real events. And in his last novel, there's a conversation between himself and András Lányi, who's an environmentalist, a conservative-minded environmentalist, but a great opponent of the government in some ways over its nuclear building policies and so on. And they're talking about what's often a taboo subject in Hungary today, which is the relations between the Jewish community and the non-Jewish community. And they're describing how there's a conversation between András Lányi is someone of Jewish background, and Gabor Karachan is someone of non-Jewish background, a Hungarian national patriotic person who took part in 56 in those terms. And they're talking about how the Holocaust was possible, how it happened. And they're speaking about Hungarian Jewishness and its patriotic nature, for example, in the First World War, how the Jews of Hungary, you know, and this city, Budapest, in 1900 was 25% Jewish. And the conversation goes on that what happened at Trianon when Hungary was divided after when historic Hungary was divided after the First World War was that the Hungarians didn't start hating the Jews, but they became indifferent to them. Pope Francis's word, the globalization already in the 20th century of indifference. And that was how so many Hungarian Jews were taken away why Hungarians didn't lift a hand to prevent that happening. And this indifference, I think, if we look at what's going on with the refugees today, it's not that Hungarians hate refugees. They may be afraid of them thanks to the government's poster campaign and so on. But I find it's an indifference to their fate because people aren't meeting them, because they're not establishing eye contact with them, even at the times when Hungary was allowing, up until October the 16th, 7,000, 8,000, 9,000 people from Syria, Iraq, Afghanistan across its territory every day. You couldn't actually meet them. They were being put in buses immediately and on trains. You know, it was a great, it was very well organized and shipped across the country to Austria. It's your problem now. But in Hungarian kindergartens on the border where I was, the soldiers and the police who'd been invited by the government to patrol that border and keep these terrible people out or help them cross the country quickly, they were being invited into the kindergartens to meet the children. But what a fantastic opportunity it would have been for the kindergartens, the primary schools, the secondary schools, to invite people from Syria, Afghanistan, Iraq, into their classrooms to talk about geography, to talk about their stories, their adventures crossing the Aegean Sea only 2 weeks earlier and so on. And so I think, to, in a roundabout way, coming back to what you were saying, Jory, about the possibilities in the arts today about the locality, about not necessarily apart from international and national cooperation, this local cooperation, when you establish the eye contact in the media, when we speak about thousands of people, a flood of humanity, a river or a trickle of humanity, we are also guilty of not identifying the names, the faces, the individuality of each of the people coming and of each of the people standing there at the roadside wondering who is coming to visit, to live in, to pass through our community. And this, I think this is something which the arts can always do, which the media should do more, even the mainstream media, that, like the ones I represent, can do more, which is just to establish the, to make that eye contact. And this is also one of my own fears about social media and about the games children play and teenagers play today on social media, that there's less eye contact there between people than maybe they used to be. Any thoughts on that?
Perfect.
Any more? We've got a little bit more time. Yep, there's someone there.
Come halfway. Hi, my name is Pippa. I lived in the UK for 15 years, but I now am based in Australia. I just wanted to pick up on a couple of points, of course, to reiterate Willie's point about the importance of public funding, but some concern over idealising what happens in the UK, because I think that actually a recent survey done this year, the Warwick Report, said that between 8 and 10% of the population is engaging with subsidised culture. That's very small, really. And there is a very exciting movement, I think, that is not being talked about enough in the cultural sector, but is coming through activism, particularly around the environment and economics and climate change. And this is particularly around food production and energy production, the shared economy. And we are not talking enough about that in our sector. And in some ways, this idea of market, this very old-fashioned idea of market that is failing us globally, is really not the future, I don't think.
Really interesting to understand your vision, because you said I have a very bad vision, because what I see from my I'm from Italy, okay, what happened in these 20 years is that it was it has been like an erosion little by little, you know, we can feel it, you know, day by day, but something was missing, you know, and in the end you realize that going back 10 years ago, it was like, you know, we lost many money in public funding, but which are the strategy now? I mean, because is there any strategy, an institutional strategy in that? Because if we think about that, it's the point. If it's a strategy, it's really a risk. I mean, if it's not a strategy, but they are trying to find a way, okay, we can create a dialogue. I don't know, you know. But if they know where they are going, it's really a totalitarianism.
You know, I agree. You know, I guess each institution, or many institutions, who feel responsibility. I guess the strategy build on responsibility. So those who know, aware of responsibility, I guess they built the strategy. So what I can say, I didn't talk to Katynoshev Theater and or very profoundly with Kretaker, but I feel it. You know, if you are an expert or let's say you visit these institutions and artworks very often, you feel it. That's a question that this kind of let's say resistance against the market, against this kind of policy or politics, does it have a coherent platform? Because that's the the key issue. Because in Hungary, we are very weak in that. So that's why there is no resistance. There are no crowd on the street when we want a. Long time ago.
20,000 people last year prevented attacks being imposed.
No, it was 100,000. I heard that. No,
it was some exaggeration.
I was not there.
Two days ago in Romania, 20,000 people brought down a government.
So anyway, that's a question. Why we don't do that? I have a certain answer here because of education system, the taxation system, and so on and so on. There are many things in the society which serves that your dignity and your personal sovereignty melt down. You know, but it starts from your childhood. And that's what I can see here all the time. So that's why we are really easy victim of this erosion, of this corruption process, which is not all the time about money. It's a moral question. And, you know, I guess the role of the art should be to point it out. I was on an after talk, Art by Chilling. He addressed this question. What do you think about corruption? And the people were really the cream of the highbrow people, you know. And they so pushed away this issue for them. I was really surprised. So this is like the Jewish questions. So our 56, so many things. We don't have to really go deeply to the main essence of the question. So the art is, this is one role of the art is very important. The other one is what I also learned recently, because I was surprised, because after when the immigration battle went on online, it turned out many of my friends were against so much against the migration. How should I say? Migrators? Or?
Migrants.
I was really, so it was another division in our society. The line was totally somewhere else where it was before. So that was, for me, it's a big, big surprise. And I learned one more thing. It became much more clear. So that's the cooperation is so important, because those who had met, for example, with a Lebanese or a, not Italian, of course, any African or any Asian, and they knew what does it mean, you know, then they had an experience. They knew how they behave differently. And they knew a little bit why they behave differently. So they have much more open, much more yielding, much more cooperative. And those who really just in the countryside, living in a village, they don't have job, or even they have a job that's local, they don't meet people.
What is for them, this situation? The enemy is coming, they take away the job. You know, that's what you just said. So the art must have a new role. This is kind of participation, how to make a kind of collaboration and to make a bigger and larger society, which is way, in a way a communication too. And it's important because this way we can generate public also. So this is my question.
I have a quick reaction to the question about strategies. And I think, as Yuri mentioned, you can even if we don't know, we can see that some institutions have strategies, which is a good thing. But the major problem, and you pointed it out, we would need a kind of national cultural strategy to see where our nation would like to go, and it would be easier to integrate then these institutional strategies. And again, going back to my London work, that was a major difference. And obviously, I'm not completely idealized the British system, but at least they have strategies. And that's why it was a tremendously difficult job to represent Hungarian culture there, because working with the government, and in Hungary, all the funds is for a year period. And as far as I know, Arts Council England gives us 3 years fund, and this is just a tiny thing, but they understand how culture works. You cannot plan things in a year. So, I mean, that was hugely difficult for me to get in a British institution where they plan 5 years, and my term was 4 years, and to make understand my government that we have to dedicate, yes, this exhibition there 2 years before. And it was constantly a gambling, and this is maybe, I'm not happy it's recorded because it's a bit off record, but a lot of director, we were really gambling to say in the UK, yes, I promise, here's the kind of letter from the ministry that we will pay, we will do this exhibition, etc., etc. But I knew that it was not true, because here all the funding scheme is for a year period, which is a tiny little thing, but it shows that unfortunately strategies and vision in a kind of national level, I think it's missing, and it's equally important, I think, as money.
Hi, Margaret from the United States. I'm just struck by the incredible metaphor of being on this beautiful cultural space, which is a ship. Here we are in a country whose cultural policy, despite the pressure from outsiders and from their own colleagues in Europe, and certainly from abroad, including the US, is insisting on its own sovereignty, insisting on making itself an island. And we are the cultural workers, both inside and out, who are trying to ply the waters. I'm not comparing us to immigrants, of course, but it's just a very powerful metaphor today. I really appreciate this conversation.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Hi, everyone. Goran Tomko from Serbia. I'm really struck, I guess, as most of us, with this image of the faceless crowds crossing our countries. But I would like to draw a parallel to another crowd, like a faceless crowd, that we also talk in a similar fashion, and that is actually our audiences. Too often we talk about our audiences or publics or whatever in a very similar fashion. And I think in art world, we really too often maybe talk about ourselves, and when we talk about others, it's some distant, unknown, faceless other. If we want to change or to contribute to a change, we need to change that, I think. Thanks.
Yes, thank you very much for this remark, because this is exactly what I would like to answer to the remark of the French colleague who asked about what kind of work with the audience, and what is the artists or art organizations' reaction towards this new phenomena, and I to give some encouraging examples that. By the end of this discussion. So for instance, here and now in Hungary, all these kind of outreach programs and audience development programs, which are in the performing arts scene, are in their early phase, so it's quite a recent phenomena, but are very enthusiastically and intensively reacted by general audiences, faceless audiences, as you mentioned, and since there are more and more theaters, more and more organizations, or even the orchestra I work for is a pioneer in this work. When you make direct encounters with the youngsters or less young people interested in the artwork or in these creative moments of co-producing something, so there this relationship changed radically. And I know that in many of your countries it has been a long tradition, but in Hungary it's just starting now, and we have very, very good experiences on them. And at the University of Theatre, where I'm teaching, there is I'm responsible for a new class which does this theatre and education professionalism, for instance, and professionalization. And there is also a big interest and a very good climate around this. So I think that you're absolutely right. We have to explore new ways of involving audiences, meet them, break this wall of indifference, create opportunities where this eye contact can be made. And I think that there is, as in Hungary, the percentage is the same as you mentioned, that 10% of the population is intensively involved in state-subsidized cultural programs. So we have to reach out more. We have to go to places where this kind of culture never gets, and we have to go there not only with an artistic vision and a ready-made art program, but with our toolkit and create moments where people can discover new experiences. And fortunately, I can witness many of these kind of initiatives here in our country. Of course, they are extremely small scale, but if you do that and if you are persistent in doing that, it will help to create a new audience and ensure that there will be people attending the mainstream events also in the future, or creating something completely different as they wish in alternative ways.
Yes, maybe we've just got like a few more minutes on the whole question. Each of you are teaching the arts in different ways. Just picking up on what Mate said, Ildikó, what are you teaching now? What needs to be taught? Is it the same as that always has been, or is there something new or different? What needs to be taught in this country today?
Well, it's now. I'm going to answer it for two different perspectives. One is more like the art perspective, so the content perspective, which I think critical view and braveness to ask questions and braveness to think. I think that's crucial in Hungary to incentivize people in the universities, but even younger kids, to learn this kind of dialogue or discussion culture. So not always accept what it's taught, always question what is taught. And I was just recently at the CEO on an interesting seminar, and that was exactly what they were talking about. That even in CEU, which I think it's an island in Hungary, the Central European University, I studied there, so that's really an island, and even there, it's an issue how to engage, involve, made the students more critical. So that's the content answer, and also just reflecting, ending this, that I was recently in Germany at the Schilling Children Film Festival, and it's about also education, and it's reflecting what you were saying about the refugee crisis. At the opening of the festival, one of the representatives of the city asked the German pupils, kids, to help refugee kids in the school. And even when I'm saying this, that was so strong, because that was for kids. There was thousands of kids, different age groups, from 6 till 14, 16. And so that was the main main kind of opinion in Germany that openly said, so I would have wished that in Hungary would have happened the same, which reflecting what you're saying. On the practical side about education, which I just did a survey about film education and film practice and training in Hungary, and it came out that the practice-based art education and film education, for example, is quite missing, but it's an old debate in film education that how content-based and how artistic-based and how practice-based should it be, so it's not a new question. But it turned out that in Hungary, I think especially Marty can say about the University of Film and theater drama, that I think that's not bad, this kind of artistically thought film education. And so actually one of the finding of my research was that where Film Fund can step in, that somehow connect the industry, film industry and the film education. So somehow make possibilities to filmmaker to try out and not immediately step in the big competition to put together a film and to apply for the Hungarian Film Fund. And even they started already an incubation program, which again for first filmmakers can help to get in the market. So the entry in terms of film, I can speak about that only right now, is really make it easier to entry to the film making practical market.
So it's what I experience. I have to emphasize all the time that be systematic, be organic, look for a long vision, and then. I guess these are the three key points for me, and there's a frame, and the frame is that crisis management. So because in Hungary that's typical, it's ongoing crisis, no money, no system, no vision, and so on. But in this among these circumstances, you have to exist, you have to work, you have to get ahead, and there's one point when you have to step out from one person management to work with a group of people, with employees. That's a very, very crucial point, and I can see many, many failures at this point. And then the other point is that how to work internationally, which is a big problem, because if there is no touring here, it means you don't understand the system there, and you have to step out, everybody expect from you that you have that knowledge. You know, this is very, very specific Hungarian situation in performing art. So that's all.
Just very, very briefly, I'm not fully agree with what you said, Yuri, just to create some tension by the end of the discussion, because I think that talking about Hungary, there is money, there is system, and there is a long-term vision. When I meet students, younger generation, future professionals, I have the chance to work with at the theater university. The challenge for me is how to introduce them into these existing system, because what we definitely lack is transparency. So it's very, very difficult to understand and learn how these big structures, which are crucial for the operation of our society, are created and run. So for me, it's one of the biggest tasks to explain them, and also to make them more reflective and critical about the systems that. That influence our daily life, and I'm every time I'm really shocked to see how little they know about, and I think it's partially connected to the media consumption a bit. So they don't read newspapers, they don't so they just pick up quick information from the net. But it's also a sort of indifference towards our own issues. So I think. I see there a huge responsibility for any kind of education, whether it's management, whether it's outreach or audience development projects, and I see that the value of that kind of expertise is becoming more and more important, and not just because artists need these kind of professional helpers or supporters, but also because having this kind of mentality or having this kind of reflective position towards what's going on around us makes you a more valuable and a more autonomous or less easy to corrupt person in our society. And I see there are still a lot of people willing to become so.
Thanks. There's one more comment here.
Hello, sorry, loud voice. Hello, my name is Liz Pugh and I work for an independent arts organisation in the northwest of England. And I just want to add something to the conversation and tell you about yesterday, IETM organised some pre-trips and I went on a pre-trip to an area of Hungary where Spec Street Association are working with Roma youth, and a conversation we saw work that the organisation is doing with Roma young people and in schools, and it was a really a fascinating day. And I suppose I was surprised. We were in a little minibus, a microbus, and there was only, I think, 10 of us. And I suppose I would say to everybody, and I know it you people have to take time out of work and whatever, but if you're coming to an event like this, a conference, and there is a pre-meeting trip organised, in the interests of knowing something of where we are and looking people in the eye, we did a circus skills workshop as part of the day. So there was 25 Roma young people and 10 of us informal European theatre meeting professionals. And we all balanced something on our head and walked around the room and said hello to each other. And to do that, we had to looking each other in the eye, and we became equal in that moment. And I suppose my first thought is, take the opportunity if it's offered. There should have been more than 10 people. We could have had a big bus, but we only had a small bus. And the other thing to say was, the conversation that happened in the minibus on the way back with Balash, who runs that organisation, we were talking about leadership, and we were discussing how we might use theatre and the skills that we have as theatre professionals to create, to help create the leaders. And I suppose looking at training the other way, yes, of course, there's the how do we train theatre professionals, but also remembering that the very brilliant skills that theatre makers have of storytelling, of making connections, of finding the humanity that connects us, those skills are fundamental, and we should be looking, all of us, at how we are working with the next generation. I speak as a not young person, and so, you know, making those connections. There, that's it. Thank you.
Thank you very much. We should slowly be finishing, I think. I would offer one final image of my own as well. A friend of mine was traveling to the United States with a group of Hungarian folk musicians in the last year or so. And sitting next to her on the plane was a woman from Transylvania, a Hungarian ethnic background from Transylvania, who'd never been on an airplane before. And she was very worried before they got on the plane. And to the surprise of the others traveling with her, she slept the whole way. She shut her eyes before takeoff, and when they landed, it wasn't in New York, it was further across. I can't remember where, it was a 9-hour journey or something. She opened her eyes and people started congratulating her. How did you sleep all the way, you know, if you were so worried before? And she said, I wasn't sleeping, I was praying. And as I see the refugees arriving in Europe today, how many of them are praying all the way, and how, when we speak about defending Christian culture, are we neglecting how many believers are arriving among us who are praying all the way here, just as many of us are still in our own ways praying all our way there or wherever else we go on our holidays or on our trips around our towns. So thank you all very much for taking part this morning. Thank you very much for coming. And some words about the organization before everyone gets up.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Nick. Thank you, Ildiko. Thank you, Mate. Thank you, jury. It was great to have your views on the situation here. The Trans Europe Hall mob and the IETM mob will split. Our ways will split. I asked the IETM people to go back to Aquarium. If there's half an hour before our first working groups start, be it in the Central European University, in D17, which is very near to Aquarium. There has been a wrong address circulating, but realize the address is very near to Aquarium, or in Aquarium. There are three working groups starting at 12:30. If you don't manage to get your badge and to register before that time, don't panic. We have the registration desk will be open afterwards and you will be allowed in without a badge, by exception. It is in Aquarium. You can walk along the river until you meet the tramway 47. Take that one and it brings you. The terminal is at the same square as where you find Aquarium. Sorry? It's the end of the 47 line, yes. Or 49, okay. Thank you so much. One of your compatriots said democracy is an acquired taste, and maybe we didn't get enough time to acquire that taste. We will discuss the role of the artist in democracy for the oncoming days. Thank you.
I'm very sorry, too, because I was in the other room following the debate. Okay, it's Maurizio Settembri from Fabrica Europa. I want to ask you your help and your support, because yesterday evening we get the news that our wonderful place, Stazione Leopolda, which is known for all the artists of everywhere, will be sold in all'asta, in consumption, will be sold the 2 of December. And this is a new that Railway Society decided to do without asking anything to the other, the city, the region, and everywhere. So at this point, it is very difficult in 25 days to organize the possibility also to participate to this, to organize that this wonderful place, which is an heritage, is really one station of the 18th century. It's been built in 1850.
May I please, let's start a communication about that, because I think we have to.
Okay.
Yeah.
And so what I ask to you is if you agree that all together we ask to the institution to have to be democratic. That means to open a panel of discussion about we can all together, the artist and the international community with the institution, to save this wonderful, fantastic place for the contemporary in Florence. Thank you for your support. I will send you a letter to everybody. Thank you.
Okay.